Hi everyone, Ski Oakenfull here, and it's great to be back for the first Deconstruction of 2022. Welcome along, my name's Ski Oakenfull and I'm the Head of Education and Curriculum here at Point Blank Music School. So I'm going to be doing a deconstruction today and I'm going to be deconstructing the Weeknd's Blinding Lights. Let's have a few fun facts about the track. So it's written by Abel Tesfaye, aka The Weeknd, Ahmed Bulsh, Jason Quinneville, Max Martin and Oscar Holter, and was actually produced by The Weeknd and Max Martin and Oscar Holter too. Released back in 2019 on the 29th of November. It came out on EXO and Republic, and it was from his album from 2020, After Hours. The track did incredibly well, number one in more than 32 countries. Last time I checked, it had 550 million YouTube views. And yeah, style-wise, it's like synthwave, synth-pop, electro-pop, really influenced by the 80s, in particular by Rod Stewart's Young Turks from 1981. And yeah, when I discovered this, I was really amazed actually, because you can hear it's got a similar tempo, similar key signature, similar kind of feel. So let's have a listen to that now. So really similar vibe there. And then also this very famous track by A-ha, Take On Me, which I think the kind of main melody line might have been influenced by. So let's have a quick listen to that. There we go. Okay, so for this deconstruction, I'm going to be using Ableton Live 11, and it's the suite version, and also a Push 2. And this is the hardware that works in conjunction with the software. I've also got a Native Instruments Complete M32, which I'm going to be using to put in some of the keyboard parts. So let's get started. What I'm going to do is just go through the different elements of the track, the beat, the bass, the chords, and the melody, and just build up an arrangement in Ableton Live. And if you're not familiar with Ableton Live, there are two main scenes. You've got the session view, which I'm in at the moment, and that's where you can see grids and the clip. And then we also have a range view as well. So let's start off with the beat, and for this I've just got four sounds. I'm using something called a drum rack here, so let's just play those sounds. I've got a kick drum, a snare, a big clap with a big reverb on it, and a hi-hat sound as well. So I'm going to put the metronome on. I'm also going to put the record quantize on as well, so that everything I play is going to be recorded in time. So let's put in the first beat. There we go, so that's two bars. Let's take the metronome off now. And you can see the tempo is actually really fast. We're at 171 BPM here. So what I want to do now is add a hi-hat over the top. So I've got a hi-hat sound here, and I'm gonna make use of the repeat function, which means that when I hold down this pad, it's just gonna play 16th notes. So let's just record that. There we go. Now there is this other sound, which is this clap. Let's take the repeat off. But this comes at the end of an 8-bar section. So what I can do is just double this loop twice to turn it into an 8-bar loop. So let's just double it twice. There we go. And then I'm just going to select those last two bars and I'm just going to record that clap sound. There we go. So I'm going to turn it back into an 8-bar loop there. And we've got our first clip, which you should be able to see there. Now, using Push, I can actually copy that clip down to the different scenes, because by creating these horizontal scenes, that's going to build up the different sections of the track. So I'm just going to click on Duplicate. There we go. And I've duplicated it down three more times, so we've now got four scenes. Okay, so let's go to the next sound now, and this is a bass sound. And I'm just going to show you what that is. This is actually using the Ableton Live device called Analog. Actually a sound I used for a previous deconstruction by Kavinsky. And I've actually mapped the filter cutoff on my complete control here, just to this rotary knob. So I can play with that later to kind of give some more dynamics and feel to the track. Now would be a good time to talk about some of the music theory behind this track. So I'm going to bring up my keyboard. And I'm also going to bring up these chord charts here. And let's just go on to another sound for the moment, just to demonstrate this. When I'm doing these deconstructions, I always look for what the key signature is going to be of the track, because that's going to dictate the notes and the chords that are played. Now this is quite a tricky one, because it could have two different key centers. Now the one that I prefer is saying it's C minor, so C is the tonic. These are the notes. And in that case, the chords are going to be this F minor, C minor, E flat, and B flat. And we can define those chords based on the degrees of the scale. So if we call it C minor, the F is the fourth degree, so this is going to be the four chord. But if you look it up on Wikipedia, it will actually say that it's using the F Dorian, which is this. So it's the same notes of the scale, but it's implying that the key center is F. And actually, to build the F Dorian, you would do that from E flat major, which is the relative major of C minor. So all those things are working together, but I'm just going to go with what I think, which is the fact it's in C minor. So I'm just going to get rid of that. Okay, so let's just quickly talk about the chords. So I said the first chord was F minor, and this is actually an inversion. This is the second inversion. So if we just play the root of F minor, is that, that's called the root position. Then we take this bottom note up an octave, that's the first inversion. Then we take this note up another octave, we have the second inversion. So that's why it's got two in brackets. Then we have C minor, which is the root position. E flat, that's the first inversion. And B flat, that's the second inversion. So we've got 4, 1, 3, and 7. And let's go back to the bass now. And what the bass is going to do is just play the root notes of those chords. So we've got F, C, E flat, and B flat. And I'm going to play some passing notes as well, which is going to make the bass line a bit more melodic and give it a bit more interest. So let's record that in now. There we go. And what I can do now is I can actually vary that filter cutoff as it's playing along. Now I'm not going to record it in. We can just leave that for the performance at the end. Okay, so I'm going to do the same thing I did with the beat. I'm just going to duplicate that clip down to the four scenes, because actually that bass line stays the same throughout the whole track. And then I'm going to go over to the chords. I'm just going to play those straight in over the top, and they're just very straight. They're just always on the beat. So let's record those chords in. Let me just show you what I'm using for this. I'm actually using another sound from that deconstruction, the Kavinsky deconstruction, and this is a really nice synth brass sound. I've used some of the Ableton Live Chorus effect on that. Let's just show you what that sounds like with and without. So this is without, and then with. You can hear it really kind of widens it out and makes it really kind of warm and lush. So let's duplicate that down to scenes 3 and scenes 4. And then we can move on to the next part, which is the melody. This is using a real favorite synth of mine. It's a third party synth. It's the Tal Uno LX, which is a version of the Roland Juno 60. And this is the part that is being played. Now this just comes in this one section. It's the kind of intro section. It's really kind of embedding that hook, that melodic hook for the track. So yeah, let's record that in. So we're nearly there with the music. There's one more part to put down, which is this arpeggio sound. So So an arpeggio is like a broken chord. It's like playing the notes of the chord in a sequential way. So rather than just playing them all down in one go, I'm just playing them rhythmically in a sequence. Now, this is another Ableton Live sound. Let me just bring it up. Again, this is another analog. I love the analog device. It's fantastic. And I've done the same thing I did with the bass. I've actually mapped this controller knob here to the filter cutoff. I've got some other effects on here as well. I've got the sound toys, a little micro shift. I'll just take that off. That's a bit like a chorus as well. It's a really nice effect. And then I've got my favorite reverb, which is the UAD EMT 140, kind of plate reverb. Cool, so let's record that. Now I'm gonna record this onto scenes 2 and 4. And you'll see how this works when we play the track at the end. So I'm just gonna select the scene here. Let's record it in. So now what I can do is actually manipulate the filter cutoff for both the bass and that arpeggio. So let's just duplicate that down to the fourth scene, and we've now got our four scenes. So I can just play through those very quickly now, and I can trigger these from push here. So this is just playing these horizontal scenes. That's the first one. Second one. Third one. And then the fourth one. And this is where the arpeggio comes in. In order to give myself a little bit more flexibility when I'm playing through this track, I'm actually going to do some grouping. I want to be able to mute the musical parts and just have the beat by itself. So I'm going to select the bass, the chords, the melody, and the arpeggio, and I'm going to hit Command G, and that's going to put it into a group. So let's just do some housekeeping and name that. Let's just call that music. There we go. That just means if I just now play this, and while I have this group selected, I can hit mute, and that will just mute all of those parts just by putting it into a group. So a really, really useful feature. Okay, so as is customary with these deconstructions, let's have a listen to this with the acapella. So I actually extracted this acapella, and I'm just gonna drag it over here. There we go. So let's just have a play of that soloed and listen to what it sounds like. Oh, I've been on my own for long enough. Maybe you can show me how to love. Maybe. So you can hear it's used some sort of acapella extractor, but it sounds pretty good. There are a few sort of artifacts in there, but I think it's good enough to play over the instrumental that I've created. So let's play through, and I'll do a little bit of playing around with the filter cutoffs and a bit of muting here and there, and let's hear how that sounds. So here we go. Back to the melody. So there we go, I've put the track together. Now you remember earlier on, I played the Rod Stewart track. So I was thinking it'd be really interesting to listen to what the a cappella of Rod Stewart, how Rod would sound over this backing music. So what I've done is I've actually taken the original track and I put it into this software called Neural Mix Pro. Now this is a really fantastic piece of software that makes the process of splitting up the different elements of a track, for example, the vocals, the harmonic parts, the bass and the drums, and then you can actually export those parts out to play in your track. So it's a really good way to try an a cappella. Maybe you want to try a remix just, you know, on the fly, just see how it goes. So yeah, let's just have a play of this. I've put it into here and you can hear all the elements together. So I can just solo the bass, solo the drums. Let's try soloing the vocal. So really brilliant. Even just the music, harmonic parts. So it's really powerful software. There are kind of websites that allow you to do the same, but this is really great and it gives you things like the key signature. It's actually saying this is an E flat and the BPM as well. Once you've decided what you want to use, you can just click on export and then you can just choose which part you want to export. So I've actually done that already and I've put that into Ableton Live. If we just scroll down here, you can see I've taken that and I've done a bit of work. I've kind of synced it up. I've done some warping. So if we just put that back on now, and I'm just going to solo the original a cappella. There we go. So what I can do is I can actually play that along with the session view and the backing track that I've created. So let's just have a listen. Pretty good, not bad. So there we go, not perfect, but you know, Rod, if you're out there, maybe you want to come along and we can do a bit of a mashup version, that'd be fantastic. So there we go, I hope you enjoyed that deconstruction of the Weeknd's Blinding Lights. I look forward to being back again soon.